Tridib Chakravorty is also there. So without further ado, I will request I will just introduce dignitary principal of Ramlal Anand College, Rakesh Kumar Gupta, whose academic career is almost of 3 decades, and he has done his postdoctoral from the Center of Environment and Biotechnology, Department of Microbiology, University of Tennessee, Knoxville, United States of America. He has published extensively in reputed journals and research papers. And sir, we feel privileged that you are part of this August academic gathering. And we look forward for such a future collaborative event with your college in the near future. So I directly now go to Dr. Pallavi Sinha Das to introduce our first speaker of the day, and we start the program. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Hello.
You are audible, ma'am. You go ahead. Yeah, you're audible. Okay. Go ahead.
Good morning, everyone. I take an immense pleasure to host this program on rural and unwork awareness issues and challenges. I will introduce my first speaker, Professor K.K. Pandey sir. Sir has his PhD in economics on fiscal instrument for municipal services from Agra University. He has also done a course on population studies, East-West Center, University of Hawaii, USA, advanced course on urban management, University of Birmingham, UK, internet-based course on municipal finance from Cardiff University. Sir has various awards and honors. He is member of expert committee to review National Capital Region Plan 2020 NCR Planning Board, New Delhi. He has been member of 7 UN expert groups to deliberate on urban habitat, finance, governance issues. Sir has specialized training of trainers on local government management, Foundation of Local Development, Romania, and leadership and management for local leaders, New Delhi, course on direct training skills, Human Settlement Management Institute. Sir has vast experience of more than 35 years, and he has also experienced in urban human settlement sector since 1980 at National Institute of Urban Governance Affairs, Human Settlement Management Institute of GUDCO and IIPA. Has followed urban sector in India and elsewhere closely since global attention on decentralization and central habitat. He has coordinated more than 40 consultancy research studies of high repute and was a member of team in another 20 studies. He is coordinating with manpower assessment of urban services, role of state training institution in the implementation of Swachh Bharat mission, energy efficiency in eco-cities. Sir is being associated as a member of executive council of IIPA since 2014. He's member of editorial board of Nagar Law, member of editorial board of Asian Review of Public Administration. And sir has a vast global experience for 37 years. He has visited different parts of India, which as a subcontinental dimension during several assignments, visited 27 countries for various professional assignments and engagement in the areas of specialization, including US, UK, Bahamas, Belgium, Brazil, Canada, Germany, Korea, Romania, and the list goes on. I'll not take so much of time. Sorry, sir. I'm just taking a few of the things from your comprehensive CV so that the listeners can hear you more. And sir will be talking up, on the topic post-COVID urban governance in the title. And sir, we invite you for the lecture.
Jiteen, just unmute principal, sir, before, please. He has been muted. You have to unmute him for his address.
Yes, yes, he's one minute. Yes, sir. Principal, sir, you are unmuted. You can. Hello, Professor Rakesh, sir. Can you hear
me? Yes, yes.
Okay, sir.
Good morning, all the dignitaries, speakers, participants, and the members of the organizing team. On behalf of Ramlal Anand College, I extend a hearty welcome to Professor Mrityunjay Chatterjee, Dean School of Liberal Arts and Culture Studies. I think he is here joined us, head of the Department of Political Science and also one of the important organizer of this webinar, Dr. Jitendra Nayak. The members of the organizing team, esteemed speakers, Professor Pandey, Professor Jaina, and all the participants to this national e-symposium on urban and rural governance, jointly organized by the political science departments of both the institutes. And I express my heartfelt thanks to Professor Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Deependra Jha, who has allowed us and provided us an opportunity for holding and collaborating together to organize this symposium on a very significant topic of these days. Of course, we have with us Professor Pandey, who is very well known personality in governance, both urban and rural. He has headed a number of committees. I have just few points to make over here, looking at the present scenario, which has arisen due to COVID-19. Rural and urban governance, of course, has been a challenge since independence before all the governments. And this challenge had turned into a disaster now. I would call it disaster, looking at the widespread movement of villagers, the workers from urban to rural areas. That is their native place. Government has come forward with a number of packages to engage all these migrant workers at their native places to provide them sufficient sources of income to survive. And everyone has suddenly started talking about the plight of these workers, these villagers, and has started thinking about generating jobs in rural areas through enhancing agriculture productivity, installing new medium and small scale enterprises, providing them training, technology, right, which were never thought before. Though if you look at the principles of Mahatma Gandhi, it should have been done since independence. Why we were not able to generate sufficient jobs, why we were not able to take up the industry to the village level, that's what we are basically, we are looking at now. So governance means providing drinking water, provisions of cleanliness and sanitation, primary health care, education, and sufficient employment opportunities to all the villagers so that they can stay at their native place, work over there, and don't have to move around if we have to prevent the similar episodes in future. And it is very important, as when we talk about the consensus, the rural population was about 84-89% in 1951, which has now reduced to only 59%. That means most of these have moved from rural area to urban area in search of jobs for better opportunities and better life. So if we could have provided that life at the village level, I think we would not have seen such a problem what has arisen today. I hope the speakers like Professor Pandey, Professor Jaina, who are specialists in this field, will deliberate to provide insight as what kind of models can be placed in governance so that exodus from rural areas is prevented, to maintain a fine balance between the development of rural and urban areas. I thank again the organizers to think about such a wonderful topic, thoughtful topic for the webinar, and hope all will be enriched to listen to our esteemed speakers. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Nair.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. So directly we will go to Professor Pandey. And hello, am I audible? Yes, sir. So we'll be sharing your PowerPoint presentation. Pallavi, ma'am?
Yes. Yes, sir.
Yes. So can we have sir's presentation? Just 1 minute. I'll just share it. Rana Pratha, can you share sir's?
Okay, sir. I'm sharing.
Okay. Okay, so sir, we have your PowerPoint presentation, which is shared with all the audience. So you can go ahead, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Naik. Please ask admin to change my name because the Zoom was downloaded by on this other name. That's why the name is coming.
Okay, okay, okay. We'll try, but we'll try to change your name. Okay.
Honorable Dr. Rakesh Kumar, Professor Rakesh Kumar Gupta ji, Principal Ramlal Anand College, University of Delhi. Dr. Jiten Naik ji, Head of the Department, Political Science Department in the Adamas University, Kolkata. My fellow panelist S.K. Jaina ji, Dr. Nidhi Yadav ji, and Dr. Pallavi Sen ji. I thank you all for your very kind invite to share my views on this contemporary issue on which the entire globe is struggling. And in this context, the title of today's webinar, Urban and Rural Governance, is very important and need attention from all professionals and academicians and practitioners. Next slide.
Next slide, please.
Urban and rural development go hand in hand. Both are complementary to each other. Urbanization will happen, is happening, it is inevitable because the agriculture sector cannot hold the workforce that is there in our country historically. It happened not only in India, across the world, that ultimately agriculture is holding 15% to 20% population in the villages and workforce also in the same proportion. This started as part of industrialization in Europe in the 18th century when expansion of industries and manufacturing and services took place in Europe and followed the dispersal of economic activities, which means production shift wherever it is cheaper. Europe got highly urbanized. Only 15 to 20% population in Europe was living in urban areas. Then the production shifted to US. From US to Japan, from Japan to newly industrialized countries, that is Korea, Taiwan, Hong Kong, and from there, Southeast Asia, and then South Asia, China, Africa, and other South. So this is the global process of urbanization and industrialization and economic development, which go hand in hand. In 1800, the global population living in urban areas was 3%, which crossed 50% mark in 2007. In India, recently, the census was held, in the recent census was held in 2011, and the urban population was 31.2%, which was much ahead, above, than the 17% in 1951. Next. The COVID, the Corona or COVID-19 has affected cities adversely. It has stopped all the economic activities during the lockdown. And in India also, the same is seen. Corona is entering through cities, and large cities, particularly among seven states, 10 to 15 cities, were the worst hit. The migrant laborers shifted to their original places or are shifting the remaining part of them. And it started with the major cities and is expanding across the country. Next. Almost all the red districts in the country are major economic hubs, which are located in Andhra Pradesh, Maharashtra, Rajasthan, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, etc. Next. As I indicated, urban areas are origin, beginning from China, and also source of spread to towns and hinterland. Socioeconomic change is taking place. Now people are living in isolation. Health issues are very common in the hottest spot and affected areas. And there is uncertainty about the tenure of the pandemic, till what time it will remain. There is productivity loss. Economic activity is almost halted. Low-income households are the worst sufferer, and migrant laborers who came to cities for search of job are going back. The main issues felt in the major cities are space and circulation. Focus for reforms on congestion and pollution has emerged as a result of the issue of space and circulation among major cities. Our urban policies have to deal with the provision of space and circulation to urban population in a different manner, in a new normal, in a manner in which we can live life comfortably. Because we never know how much time it will take and when another virus can erupt. There are infrastructure constraints which need to be attended to provide road and other infrastructure and revive the economy. Exodus of migrant labor in this regard is most important task which need to be attended, because we never know when they will come back or whether they are willing to come back or not, or how to bring them back to revive the economy. Next. The loss of productivity is so much that initially we thought the GDP will grow at the rate of 1.9%, but now it is estimated it may be even minus. The mainly loss of productivity is visible in mega and metro cities, which are 53 as per census 2011, and it is expanding across the urban and rural areas, expanding to hinterland also. It has affected manufacturing and services adversely, which constituted 80% plus of our GDP. The millions of migrant workers had no job, and reverse migration started. And also, it minimized the capacity of city to absorb surplus labor in future. Next. Cities are centers of economic growth. They derive their origin in change in the economic profile as per our census. When the manufacturing and services, that is the non-farm sector, have 75% plus male force, male workforce, then the settlement is declared urban. So cities are centers of economic growth, and their origin is located in the economic profile dominated by manufacturing and services. The revival of urban economy is must for national revival, because 80% GDP is coming from manufacturing and services, which are located within and around cities. Will migrants come back? And if not, then what to do? How to do? Routine to digital governance is another new normal. We have to move towards digital governance as fast as possible, including the grievance redressal of the citizen. Next. Therefore, space and congestion are the challenge. How to provide them? What type of housing is needed? What type of infrastructure facilities need to be provided? The migrant workers and the gap in the services, how to bridge, how to bring back the workers, and how the urban and rural local bodies can be made capable to provide services and infrastructure in a new normal, in a different manner. Housing in this regard plays very important role to stimulate economy, because housing is very important in terms of productivity, in terms of social justice and quality of life. If one person is employed in housing, 8 are getting job elsewhere. So employment multiplier is 1:8. Income multiplier of housing is also 1:5. And also the housing sector constitute 6.8% jobs in the country. Therefore, housing is very important segment to take up when we talk about revival of the economy. Also attend current imbalances in the housing, space and infrastructure. So surplus labor also in future would be needing job. Where will they go? What would be their new destination? So the existing cities will not have the capacity. In that context, a spatial dispersal of economic activity, that is taking economic activity from some cities to larger number of cities or smaller cities or even census towns, would be prime agenda for policymakers. Next. India has competitive edge. Our demographic dividend is 62.5%. Till 2050, we are going to have demographic dividend or competitive edge. We have skilled manpower. We have informal sector in a large number. So even International Monetary Fund and other agencies are expecting a V-shaped recovery. So when we are coming down, our chances of growth are equally high. And in fact, IMF has expected 7.4% recovery during next year. For that, we have to take several measures in our urban and rural areas. Government has announced a stimulus package, credit availability, liquidity with the banks and marketing facilities, concessions, incentives to industries, particularly MSMEs. And also, it is expected that number of companies from China will move. There are different estimates, but India should be ready, should be prepared to attract, to provide them incentives, to provide them opportunity to set up their plants and units. Another is the massive highway construction, which can also attract economic activities in the surrounding areas. Next. When we see our urbanization, we find that there is huge gap. There is a diagonal divide, right from Gujarat to Tamil Nadu. The urbanization is taking place in a much higher degree than Madhya Pradesh, Jharkhand, Odisha, Chhattisgarh, Bihar, part of Eastern UP and Northeast India. So this diagonal divide needs to be corrected. The per capita income also of these states is much lower than the per capita income of urbanized states. So this COVID situation is an opportunity also to us to develop urban centers located in the districts which are having less levels of urbanization, which are aspirational districts of Planning Commission also almost two-third fall in these areas where level of urbanization is low. Census towns also, nearly 70% are located in these areas. So there is a need to develop small and medium towns and census towns among low urbanized states as a part of economic revival, which the country is going to take up very soon. Next. So urban areas not only have a V-shaped recovery, they have a V-plus potential. If we also see the existing urban centers and also the census towns and small and medium towns, particularly located in the low urbanized states. And this will need special dispersal of economic activities among 8,000 urban centers, out of which almost 3,892 are census towns, which are not having urban governments, urban government, urban governance. So these towns need to be first provided city government. Urban local body needs to be created among census towns whose number is as high as 3,900. Next. As I said, housing is a stimulator to economy, income, employment, and there is a need to bring back the construction sector when we talk about revival of the economy. How to bring the migrant workers is a big issue. And in this regard, we need to note that there is one welfare cess collected by the government, by the states on the construction sites, new construction. And in that sense, 30,000 crore is just lying unspent. That money needs to be used to boost construction activity across the country, including the small and medium towns. Government is providing incentives to MSMEs. This needs to be seen together with the development of small and medium towns, and more focus should be given on services. Next. Stimulus package is announced by the government. 50,000 crore is given to improve liquidity of banks and NBFCs. Ease of stress and credit flow is ensured. Inclusive growth for poor is particularly important in the context of MSMEs, improvement of supply chain, including the backward states, and also the City Livelihood Center and National Urban Livelihood Mission. This is very important program of Government of India to provide jobs, marketing facilities, skills to urban poor. So this NULM should be linked with the expansion of MSMEs and supply chain. There are about 5 million self-help groups, and 2.5% of population is known to be as street vendors. So these street vendors also need to be supported. Their size is somewhere between 4 to 10 million in our urban areas. And retention of labor would be a key issue in future. Why migrants are going back? Because they do not have proper space and proper infrastructure facilities at their place of stay. And in this regard, the rental housing and employee housing should be given priority. We have not given priority importance to the employee housing or rental housing for the poor. That needs to be given due cognizance in our efforts to revive the economy as a fallout of COVID. And manufacturing activities in the cities need to be taken beyond their jurisdiction in the context of the city region. Like National Capital Region in Delhi, the activities are concentrated in Delhi, Gurgaon, Faridabad, and Ghaziabad, and Noida, this part only, which is known as Central NCR. There is a need to take the economic activities beyond the physical city so that the problems of congestion and space are settled and activities are benefiting a large number of habitants. Next. Digital governance is another important aspect. Grievance redressal and public participation through citizen service center and WhatsApp groups and other team, and there are several instruments now. There is a need to scale up these initiatives. City government should have their dashboard, website, and GIS and GPS, etc., should be used in the provision of infrastructure and services and also revenue collection. The cities which are using them are showing revenue account surplus. You can imagine Ahmedabad is having 14,000 crore revenue account surplus. Revenue is more than expenditure because they are depending on digital governance, use of GIS, GPS, city dashboard, website, citizen service center. So the citizen centricity, whether in urban or rural, needs to be established, and project monitoring and on real-time basis, use of CPM part. There are several things in the digital governance which we have to introduce. There is no other way. Next. And spatial dispersal of economic activities is another equally important part. Expand economic activities among small and medium towns and census towns. Identify eligible towns among these towns, and particularly those which are located near the infrastructure network, near the national highways, near the state highways, so that connectivity is established and their economic development can be taken up in a way, as I indicated earlier. Urban local body status should be given to all the census towns. Urban sector missions should be taken to census towns. Currently, the urban sector schemes are not implemented among census towns because they are not considered urban. Once we establish city government, we can take up urban plan and urban schemes and other initiatives. And strengthen National Urban Livelihood Mission among the census towns also to integrate poor, urban poor with the economy. They can manufacture, poor can manufacture for MSME, or they can assemble things prepared by poor. So when once we take up this type of revival, economy will have potential. We, not only we, but we plus. Next. This is the network of infrastructure and towns, smaller towns located surrounding this network should be given due attention. Next. So this is again the, we can see the diagonal divide and imbalance in the urban growth, which need to be corrected so that the states which are less urbanized, which are also having low per capita income, have a chance to have economic development. Next. So finally, what I would like to conclude is that urban centers have the potential not only for V-shaped recovery, but V+, which means we have to look beyond our existing centers of economic activities located from Chennai up to Punjab. We have to move towards Jharkhand, Rajasthan, part of West Bengal, Odisha, Bihar, which are particularly the areas which are low urbanized. And in this, city government is the key. City government should play a nodal role of stimulator of economy. City government should prepare urban plan. The census towns, smaller towns, can not only be center of economic activity, but also can serve the rural hinterland in a much better manner if they are given proper urban setup, proper urban planning, proper expansion of manufacturing and services. Digital governance is equally important. We should be citizen-centric. Citizen service centers are there. Other tools are there which need to be used along with the online connectivity. Consolidation of administrative, physical, and city region. So city should look beyond the jurisdictional framework, but the city region should be benefiting from the economic expansion of city-based activities. And spatial dispersal of economic activity, as I said, is very important. And finally, municipalize the census towns with the creation of urban local body. So with this, I want to stop here.
Thank you so much, sir, for your enlightenment on the topic, which would certainly help our new researchers and all our audience. If anyone has a question with Pandey sir, they can post it in the chat box and we will address all questions after the session. Now, we have our second speaker, Professor Sebak Jana. Welcome, sir. Sir is currently a professor of economics and he is coordinator of UGC SAP DRS-1 in the Department of Economics, Vidya Sagar University, West Bengal. Dr. Jana has graduated from Residency College, Kolkata in 1989, and he did his post-graduation in economics from University of Calcutta in 1991. Sir has obtained his MPhil and PhD degree in economics from Jadavpur University, Kolkata. His major area of research includes environmental and resource economics, rural development, economics of education, yes. And sir has about 80 publications in national and international journals and edited books. He has published as an author or an editor in 6 books, including Tank Irrigation in the Dry Zones in India, Education in West Bengal, Looking Beyond Schools, Development in Developing Economies. And he, as a principal investigator, has completed a few research projects funded by ICSSR, UGC, NABARD, and International Water Management Institute. Sir, I would welcome you. And sir will be enlightening us on the topic governance and sustainable rural development, some issues and options.
So you have the PPT you can share, I guess. Yes, sir.
Hello, is it visible?
You're audible, sir.
So PPT is visible?
Yes, sir. PPT is visible, sir. Okay. Make it full screen, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. Professor Akush Gupta, Dr. Jitendra Nayak, Professor K.K. Pandey, Professor Mithindra Chakraborty, Dr. Pallavi Sina Das, Dr. Nidhi Jadhav. So thanks for giving me opportunity to share some ideas about the rural issues in this seminar. Actually, I'll be mainly discussing on the rural issues, governance and sustainable rural development, some issues and options. So as you all know, rural development is a process of improvement of the quality of the people residing in the rural areas, basically. And all the rural development basically is some land intensive or based on natural resources, particularly agriculture and forestry is very important in rural development too. And sustainable development, rural development basically deals with some combination of technical, socioeconomic, and environmental conditions. Particularly, it also looks at the linking of urban-rural linkages. So what are the policy instruments of rural development? That is, instruments used by the government, basically, to develop rural areas. It is public investment. The subsidies, maybe the fertilizer subsidies, electricity subsidies, and there are different types of subsidies that are given to the rural people. And different direct income transfer to rural households and the buffer stocks of food grains. We know the food corporation of India, they maintain the buffer stocks of food grains. The institutional credit, minimum support prices, MSP, sustainable use of natural resources, agrarian reforms, and the different types of institutions. These are the basically policy instruments used by the government for rural development. And what about the governance? What is the good governance? And good governance basically deals with the setting, application, and enforcement of different types of rules. Okay. And these rules basically pays heed to the different codes of behavior in which the authority should implement different policies. Okay. And what are the components of good governance? Basically, these are the main major components of good government. It should be based on very good policy making. It should be based on consensus oriented. People should participate in the strongly here. And there'll be a strong executive arm of the government. The transparency should be everywhere. Accountability, adhering to the rules of law, it must be responsive. It must be effective and efficient. And it also incorporates the equitability, equity, and the inclusive ideas of development. These are the major.
Professor Sebat, I have a question from here. Some of the audience, the audibility, sir. Can you some mic issue or something? Speakers, they're not able to hear.
But I am. But I am hearing, no problem.
The mic closer. Yes, sir, you can go ahead, sir. It's only a question of audibility. We can see your PowerPoint presentation. Everything is fine.
So I'm not audible.
Yes, sir, you're audible. Little bit volume, I just, that's all.
Okay, volume is less. Okay. Okay, these are the...
Yeah, you are fine, sir. Now you're louder, sir. Now you're louder.
Okay. This is the government structure. So you have the administrative unit. District magistrate, block officer, and the Gram Panchayat level, and the other is Jila Parishad Panchayat and Vishita Panchayat structure. So these are the important development programs, as you all know, that is going on for the rural development. Deen Dayal Upadhyay Gramin Kaushalya Yojana, Gramin Bhandaran Yojana, MGNRDS, Pradhanmantri Sarak Yojana, Swarnajayanti Gram Swaraj Yojana, and the very important one is the NRLM, National Rural Livelihood Mission. So these are all the programs of the government, flagship programs that is going on for the rural development. Now we come to the come to the issues of rural development. Basically, I think as you know already, the rural economy basically depends on agriculture. So I will mainly deal with the agriculture issues during the time constraint. So the major agricultural issues in India, the high dependence on agriculture. So basically, in 1951, 1 crore people was engaged in agriculture. Now in 2012, about 3-6 crore people are engaged in agriculture, and more than 40% of the workforce still deployed in agriculture. You see the how the important the agriculture sector is. About half of the world people, half of the total population depends on agriculture. And what the major issues? The major issues that are coming up in the agriculture sector is that the youth population, they are not currently very interested in the farming sector. As you see, the average age of the Indian farmer is about 50 years. Mostly the older people, they are interested in agriculture. The another problem is the paradox of plenty. As you see that the supply of the agricultural goods are more than the supply, and actually the demand, so there is the paradox of plenty, the supply, as the supply is greater than the demand, so there is a downward pressure on the price of the different commodities, and the farmers are not getting the enough price. So that is one of the issues. And the other issue is the stagnation in agricultural income. So as you as already said, the price is not covering up the cost of production for the different commodities. So the agricultural income actually is not rising, actually. As you see in 2000, it was 3,481 rupees monthly income from cultivation. It has only increased in 3,001. It's almost stagnation in agricultural income. And the other problem is low diversification of agricultural goods. As you know, basically all the most of the products are basically on the paddy. Paddy is the almond and row crop, the paddy and the cereals. There's less crop diversification. So that is a major problem. The issue of low diversification. And also there is the problem of sustainability of agriculture, the soil health. As you know, a vast tract of land, of agricultural arable land, is not arable with the soil acidity. Alkalinity is growing at unprecedented level. And also the government is introducing different types of schemes like soil health cards. So, but the farmers are not using those cards in anything. They are not enough convinced.
Excuse me, sir. Sir, sorry to disturb you in between. Sir, can you please be little loud? We are getting messages that they are not able to hear you clearly. Just little loud, sir. They can hear you, but the voice is low.
Sir, can you bring your mic to in a little further, sir? Your microphone, the mic. I think it's you're using a earphone, sir. Earplug.
Yes.
Can you bring the mic little closer, because the microphone mic which is there.
Hello.
Yeah, it's louder. Sir, are you using a laptop, sir?
Yes, I'm using laptop.
Yes, sir. I think you need to be a little closer to the laptop. Maybe that's why some of the audience are saying that they are not able to hear you.
Okay, is it audible now?
Yes, it's loud and clear. Better than before, sir. Yeah. Okay, sir.
But not perfect.
Sorry to interrupt you, sir. Sorry.
Okay, no problem.
Yes.
So there are different issues, particularly on the sustainability ground. The one is problem with the soil discussing. The soil, this most vast tract of land is alkaline and acidic. And also there's the problem of accurate water shortage. You know, you must be aware that the agricultural sector is the most user of the water. 90% of the water is actually contributed to the farming sector. So total water that has been used in the economy, that 90% is used in the farming sector. So about 80% of which the 80% is of irrigation in water intensive crops like rice, wheat, and sugarcane. So that is very important. How, why it is important to diversify from the rice, wheat, and sugarcane to other crops which are less water intensive, like pulses and valses. And another problem is that India's supply is greater than the demand, but the export potential has not been fully utilized. So as we have already, as you are seeing, the exports are rising, but in recent times, the exports of agricultural goods has fallen. So what about the COVID impact? So the recent impacts, as you have seen, the Rabi crops have been delayed because of the non-availability of labor and machinery. Farmers of perishable commodities like fruits and vegetables and flowers, they have been incurring losses because of the low price. Poultry and egg prices have crashed. Fisheries are not being able to go to the sea. And the agriculture farming and the agriculture production has been greatly hampered. And the tribal people who basically depends on the non-timber forest products in the forest area, they are also suffering from the low income because they are not able to go to the forest area. So these are the major effects that we have seen of the COVID impact in the rural economy. So now coming to the agriculture, I'm just going very fast what is happening here. So as you see, the sectoral contribution of GDP, the share of agriculture, that has fallen from 1950 to here. It's fast falling. The service sector is rising. Industry is rising moderately. So, but the share of agriculture is falling, it's true, but you see that the employment, the main employment provider in the economy is the agriculture. So you cannot ignore the agriculture sector. The steel Indian economy is very much dependent on the agriculture sector for employment and rural income. So there is the per capita production for different countries is rising, but still the unemployment is still there is undernourishment all over different areas. Now, if you compare the different countries, particularly the big economies, what is you can see the situation? The prevalence of undernourishment is still very high, 17.5%. It is Brazil 6.9%, China 11.5%. So we are at the highest percentage of children stunted is very high in India. Percentage of children in India who is underweight 43%. If compared to the other countries, it's very high compared to the other. The intensity of food deprivation. It is 125, it is an index term, it's very high compared to the big economy, human development index. But there are just the positive things to note here. The women's economic opportunity index and democracy index, that is high compared to the other states, compared to the other countries in India. So these are the positive points. Women's economic opportunity index and democracy index is higher compared to the big economy, the other big economies. Now, if we do some correlation, the relation between food deprivation and the indicators of governance indicators of food security, you see the food security is basically. So you see here the relation between the governance indicators of food security and the food deprivation. As you see the when the agricultural infrastructure, road infrastructure, port infrastructure. There is a diet diversification, sufficient supply. Actually, the food deprivation is falling. So, it indicates that the good governance actually lowers the food deprivation. So, good governance is very important from the policy point of view. Now, let us, I want to share very quickly from some primary survey we have conducted in West Bengal to get some ideas. What is happening in the field, in the reality, what is happening. So I will the reality, the case study one. It is about the renovation of water bodies, public renovation of how is the effect of the public investment on renovation of water bodies in the saline zone, which basically depends on the surface water. In the saline zone, we know that groundwater extraction is not possible because the water is saline, but only it is dependent on the surface water and that surface basically depends in South East Parkana, in West Bengal, is basically tanks and halls. And government investment was there to improve the performance of those tanks and halls. Let us see what happened. There was a national project, 47 schemes were renovated. So, two things are tanks, different areas, different blocks in South East Parkana, Sagar, Kardi, Pathe Kutima, Kulpi, Vishnupur, and Mondir Bazar. And we surveyed 440 households and 18 water bodies. So this is the area we surveyed, basically. So this is the renovation cost. So government incurred about 21 lakhs for the renovation. Average cost of renovation is 21 lakhs, and average cost of renovation is 62 lakhs, which is under national project. So what is the impact of this renovation? This is the water the characteristics of the tanks. You see, what is the impact? As you see, for almost all the crops, so we have actually grouped the households according to the who have got the benefits of renovation and who have not got the benefits of renovation. So one is treated group, another is non-treated group. So in most all the crops, we have seen that the treated groups have benefited. Their income has risen because of the public investment. And if after getting the facility of the irrigation facility, actually the poverty of the rural people has actually decreased. So irrigation, providing irrigation facilities, is very important to remove the inequality and poverty of the rural people. And also we have surveyed that whether they are willing to pay some amount for the renovation. Yes, they are willing to pay some amount in addition to the government help for the renovation of the water bodies, because they are these water bodies are very important for agricultural productivity. But there are also some governance issues, problems of tank management. So the problems of distribution channel, we have shown that the distribution channel from the water bodies to the field is not always very good. There is a culvert problem. Solar pump, water reserves association in most cases are absent. The problem is sewage gate. The water is sometimes get aligned. So there is a problem of low depth of water body. So these are the main issues. Government should take care of to improve the performance of the water body. So these are the options how to improve the aggregated performance of the water bodies. So these are the water bodies in South East Parkana. You see, these are very important. These are the water bodies. So, and the second case study, which was the earlier experiment was in saline zone. It is experiment in the dry zone, where the problem is different because of low rainfall we surveyed in Bankura and Purulia, to restore water in South is very difficult because of the land structure is there. So as you have seen, government experiment, it's a Hapa. Hapa, you see, is a very small tank which is constructed near the field of the farmer. So as you, if you go to Bankura and Purulia in the dry zone, you see that the irrigation, the water is a very problematic issue during the right season of kharif paddy, because of the poor rainfall and because of the lack of irrigation, the productivity of paddy actually gets hampered. So the Hapa is very successful model in the dry zone, as you have seen. It's a small tank. It is its cost is about 30,000. So it can be financed from the energy program. And this is the Hapa. This is the agricultural field. This is a small tank. It's very useful. So when the people do not get water at the right season, actually they take water from there. Also, there are very good effects of this. And it is constructed at the land of the farmer itself. Okay, so we have seen that this is the study area. The study area is Hirdba Park in Purulia. So this is the land structure of the dry zone. So the Hapa is actually constructed in this zone. And because of this Hapa, agricultural productivity of the small farmers, marginal farmers, have a great boost in those areas. So I have seen the vegetable and master production because it's half of the production has been increased. These are some, there are some ecological benefits of APA. So the soil and moisture conservation has increased, and also the 80% has told that the soil erosion has been checked because of the HAPA construction. There is also social benefits. So households use water from the HAPA for different purposes like bathing, washing clothes, cleaning. So these are the social advantages of HAPA. So in small tank, they can create a great benefits. What I am suggesting is that you have to innovate. We need some innovative programs which will be useful for particular cases. You cannot design a particular model which will be useful everywhere. You have to go to the field, you have to search what the major problems, you have to search the suitable model which should be appropriate, and according to that, the government should take programs and implement those, and the governance structure should support that. So, another government program I have started recently is the paddy procurement. I issue that the minimum support price, okay, that government offers to the farmer, so that the government will actually purchase the price at that price. This is called minimum support price. So as you see, this is the production, commodity production of different states. You see, the West Bengal is the highest pricing. Procurement of rice, actually procurement of rice is actually increasing over the years. This is the production and procurement of rice in West Bengal. As you see, West Bengal, the percentage of rice procured has increased in recent years. This is the minimum support price offered to the government over the years. These are the different agencies which are involved in the paddy procurement. These are the channels through which the farmer actually sales his product. As you see, the Kisan Mandi, they actually are getting this amount. But when they sell with the middleman, they actually get the lower price. This is the major problem with the farmer. They actually are not always to sell to the government. We have studied and surveyed some areas. We had some survey on their satisfaction level of the government program. So some are satisfied, some are not satisfied actually on different parameters of, these are the different parameters of government, role of the government in paddy procurement, average distance from the home to the center, number of times paddy collection in a year, behavior of the officials of the government. These are all the parameters, are all the parameters of the government. So we had collected their satisfaction level of the farmers from different parameters of the governments. So there are lots of things. I think there's more attention how the parameters should be improved. Actually, the survey actually reveals that, particularly you see that in some cases, the procedure for weighing paddy, the weighting system of the paddy at the mandi, they are not actually satisfied. But this is actually the governance issue. So these are the issues actually. Now I come to the conclusion. Conclusion for actually rural development and of course the agricultural development. We need some crop diversification. We need to emphasize on rainwater harvesting, tanks and thugs, because the groundwater is actually, there's a huge pressure on groundwater. New irrigation technology where the water should be efficiently utilized, like sprinkler system, and also the technology of different paddy cultivation system of rice intensification called SRI. Community participation in management of resources. It's not that government will always give funding for the maintenance of the community assets. People should also participate. And equitable and sustainable sharing of groundwater and surface water. Long run stable price policy, because unless there is a stable price, so people will not be interested in the agricultural sector. And we need to So the demand for agricultural goods, expansion of markets is to be the national and international, okay, increasing the demand for agricultural products, proper use of the funds of panchayat. As you see, the fund availability at the gram panchayat level, it is 2,404 at per capita over the 4 years, during the period, it's very high, 2,400. And a per panchayat is not bad. Average GP gets about 70 lakhs per year. Average gram panchayat. So if a gram panchayat plan properly and use their fund for the rural development or agricultural development, so the people will get the benefits. So also there is another issue, the increasing the farmers here. Actually, the farmers actually are not getting the proper share of the price. Okay, so there should be the different acts like the Essential Commodities Act, APMC allow farmers, because the monopoly is something the farmers are deprived of getting the full price because they are not able to sell the produce to the private banks. So we are not allowed. So this policy should be, the governance should change. So what I'm trying to aim, these are the other policies, formalization of tenancy. Actually, many in the rural areas, many out of tenants, they actually take on lease from the, but these tenants have no formalization. So when the government gives some fund to the farmer, actually, the tenant actually, who actually teams, they are not getting the fund. So that's the problem. So formalization of the tenancy, that is important. Direct benefit transfer to supplement income. Okay, so the income transfer may be direct in his own account. Rural youth should be encouraged in the proper places. There is potential, there should be the agricultural sector. Also, there should be creating alternative livelihood opportunities, forestry, floriculture, fishery. So these sectors should be exploited properly. Better market infrastructure. So unless you have good infrastructure, so it's very difficult to get the price. Minimum support price should not only be given to the paddy only, so it should be given to the, all the crops, so that the people are encouraged. So this is the last one. So how the rural economy can be boosted during the COVID-19 period. So number one, so increasing the amount of increasing the amount of government amount that is given to the farmers should be increased. It is averagely 6,000. It should be increased. Liberal expansion and funding of energy energies program, that is the flagship program of the government. So it should be boosted up. Exploring the export markets aggressively, as you know that. So in different countries, there is a huge disruption of agricultural activity. So if we export the markets where our agricultural commodities, our agriculture actually is surplus, if we export the international market where our agricultural commodities are maybe exported, then India can earn. Building rural, so actually there is reverse migration from urban to rural areas presently. So we have to use judiciously how these be utilized properly so that the rural development and the economic development could be harnessed. So those rural, those surplus labor can be used by government program or emergency program for building the rural infrastructure, creating enabling policy environment and more budget on the rural economy. So rural economy actually gets lower fund. It is actually have declined from 9.6% 2018 to 9.3% 2019. So we have seen in the COVID how the rural economy and the agriculture is so important, because the only sector that's providing some amount of employment in the economy is in the rural sector or the agriculture sector. So that allocation should be increased, and there should be smooth functioning of the supply chain. Institutional lending of kharif crops. So kharif crops will start soon. So institutional lending through bank lending should be increased, and the input markets, seeds, fertilizers, and agrochemicals should be assured. So it is. So thank you. So this is my short presentation.
Thank you so much, sir, for giving us an insight on how rural governance and sustainable development is important from the socio-economic perspective and development of a particular country. We will now take up the questions posted in our chat box. Sir, we have first question for Pandey, sir. Sir, there is a question for you asking, what would you suggest about the Act East policy in the context of post-COVID digital governance? What new mechanism or policy needed to be emphasized in this contemporary situation?
Can you repeat? I could not hear.
Yes, sir. Sure. Question is, what would you suggest about the Act East policy in the context of post-COVID digital governance? And what new mechanism or policy is needed to be emphasized in this contemporary situation?
Act East policy should cover the aspirational districts of Niti Aayog. And two-thirds of them are located in the states which have very low per capita income and which are also low urbanized. So that route through Niti Aayog would be one. And second, all urban sector and rural sector schemes and programs should give focus on e-connectivity of local governments and use to facilitate citizen through citizen service centers, use of WhatsApp groups, and also the GIS, GPS, etc. But here the connectivity in terms of online facility, that is the broadband availability, is also very important. If that is not there, how can we apply the digital governance? So the government has constituted a working group in the New Delhi at national level to ensure broadband availability in the rural areas. That I think is the most important priority, which should be immediately followed by digital governance in the economically forward-looking areas.
Thank you so much, sir. So we have another question for you asking, in the present situation, we talk of concept where city territory is merged with the rural territory. Under the circumstance, how do you demarcate the cities, metropolis, semi-urban, semi-rural, and rural concept? Is it possible to separate out the concepts looking from the territorial boundaries as we consider from the traditional concept?
In fact, 74th Constitution Amendment Act had a special provision of metropolitan planning committees and district planning committees. And these committees were expected to look beyond jurisdictional and distributional aspects. Jurisdictional aspects means they were supposed to plan for urban and rural areas both, consolidate the plans from both the local bodies, and then prepare a suitable action plan on the basis of development plan prepared in the district or in the metropolitan area. But the unfortunately, neither the metropolitan planning committee nor district planning committee have been able to achieve their task. Except a few, Mumbai and Kolkata metropolitan planning committees did some work, but they also have not been able to do it as per the letter and spirit of the act. But other states have not even set up the metropolitan planning committee. And district planning committee has become just a tool to transfer the backward area grant fund. That also varies. They are not elected body in many states. The district collector or the deputy commissioner is heading the district planning committee. they are not preparing plan. They are merely transferring the funds coming from the center. So there is a need to consolidate urban and rural planning, which was the purpose of 243 ZE and ZD, requesting district planning committee and metropolitan planning committee to be formed, which needs to be taken up in the letter and spirit in which it was conceived in the 74th. It was brought in 74th because 73rd was already passed, and then it was felt that there is a need to coordinate between urban and rural. One urban area may not have space for solid waste treatment, or may not have space for water treatment plant, or connectivity for transport would require inter-jurisdictional planning. So in that context, MPC and DPC need to be developed.
Thank you, sir. We have another question for Jana, sir, asking, do we see a bleak of umbilical relation between urban and rural India, especially from the perspective of agriculture? Will agriculture forever remain informal employment, considering the huge population engaged in the agriculture and related activities? This is for Jana,
please,
sir.
Please repeat the question.
Yes, sir. Please, sure.
The link between the rural and urban.
Yes, sir. They are talking about the question is: do we see a bright future of the relation between urban and rural India, especially from the perspective of agriculture? Will agriculture
So that's a good question. The question is that agriculture. What is the fact is that agriculture. The commodity agricultural occupation has been actually unremunerative, because the cost, the price the farmers are getting are actually not high compared to the cost. So there is a huge prospect of agriculture. The prospect is that if we find the agricultural market, there are different governments. Governmental issues are there, so if we are able to increase the demand base, so there is a huge prospect, because there is international market, there is international demand for agricultural commodities. If those demand can be harnessed, and then there is a huge prospect, and also there is a huge link between the rural and urban non-agriculture, because many of the agricultural commodities are used as raw material in the industry. So developing agriculture is very important from the industry point of view also. So given the low employability of the service sector, particularly, so we need to emphasize not only on industry, but the agriculture. So agriculture to be developed or to be remunerative, we have to diversify the different agriculture community, particularly not only paddy. We have to go for the some other agricultural rural activities like floriculture, like fishery, and the different forest-based commodities which have some market. So those diversification of commodities. Also, there is a huge lack of there is a huge demand. There is a demand for different crops like suppose pulses and oilseeds. Pulses and oilseeds are not sufficiently produced in India. So those crops should be emphasized. The farmers are not interested in these crops because they are not getting enough price from cultivating those crops. So government need to take different policies to increase their demand. Now the question is, how can this demand maybe increase? The point is that there are different types of government programs like midday meal schemes. There are different where the government uses, procure different types of commodities. So for example, if in the midday meal program, if not only the paddy is collected, the pulses and other crops are collected, then there will be incentive to huge potentiality for agriculture. We have to explore those potentialities. The point is that if we develop agriculture, then the point is that unless you do not develop agriculture, then rural income will not rise. Unless the rural income is not increased sufficiently, then there will be low demand for the industrial products. So the development is actually basically simultaneous. So development of industry actually needs the development of agriculture sector.
Thank you so much, sir. There is another question on for you, sir. Talking about current pandemic situation, what would be the possible changes might face during the rural development? What might be the possible changes or challenges for rural development in this current pandemic situation?
In the current pandemic, sir, I have discussed these issues. In the current pandemic situation, we need to take some urgent policies, because we have seen that we have huge migrants of laborers that have come from the urban sector to rural sector, we need to utilize properly those surplus labor. I have pointed out that so government funds, government infrastructure development funds like the flagship NG Energy program, the funding should be liberal. There should be huge funding for this program so that these surplus labor can be utilized. And basically, engineer this program, we can see that there are different types of infrastructures that can be built up, like the water harvesting structures, the roads, the connections, and the transport sector. These sectors should be developed with this surplus labor. Actually, if we can do that, actually there are two benefits. If the government give additional funds for these programs, actually people will get some income, and that income will be a component of the demand. Okay, so unless the demand is not harnessed, increased, then the economy actually aggregate demand will fall. The economy will not survive. So for the revival of the economy, what we need is that the government should do some cash transfer for the survival of the rural people. And also government should, the different programs, rural development programs, particularly the infrastructure development program, they should give more funds. And also government should innovate some programs, particularly not only in the agriculture, in the rural sector, but some non-farm sector. Actually, you all know that the rural sector is not fully actually agrarian. For the employment, they not only depend on the agriculture, they also depend on, actually there recently there is a shift from agriculture to the non-farm sector. And the huge employment actually is provided by the non-farm sector, like the construction sector. So these non-farm sectors, if there are potentialities for the non-farm sector, these sectors should be developed. And the allied activities in the agriculture, that should be developed.
Thank you, sir. I would request Nidhi ma'am to please take over.
Yeah, thank you so much, Pallavi. Am I audible to all?
Yes, ma'am.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Okay. So this is Nidhi. I'm here to propose a formal vote of thanks. So in the sequencing of saying vote of thanks, this is the last section of the entire event. Starting with, I extend a warm vote of thanks to Professor Dipendra K. Jha, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Adamas University, for permitting us to collaborate with your esteemed institution, sir. I extend a special heartfelt thanks to Professor Maitri Bardhan Roy, Emeritus Professor, and Professor Tridip Chakravarti for their constant guidance and support and for being there for all of us. Thank you to both of you for being present here, guiding us, blessing us, and motivating us every time. I also want to say thanks to Professor Mrityunjay Chatterjee, Dean School of Liberal Arts and Cultural Studies, Adamas University, Kolkata, who very graciously agreed to collaborate with us in this academic endeavor. Thank you very much, sir. From the side of the organizing committee, thanks are due to my very own principal, Professor Rakesh Kumar Gupta, who is always there, supportive, motivating, standing like the strongest pillar for all of us, and always remaining happy and positive for such fruitful collaborations. Sir, I want to extend a much thanks to you from this platform for always being an integral part of all the functions which we as a department and as an institution organize. Thanks are due to Mr. Jitendra Nayak, Head Department of Political Science, School of Liberal Arts, who is always helpful, supportive, positive, and is a very hard worker, a man behind giving the entire event a shape and an e-platform. Thank you so much for the support and the help you extend to both of us as event conveners. Thanks are due to our very experienced and eminent experts, Professor K.K. Pandey from the Indian Institute of Public Administration and Professor Sebak Jana from Department of Economics, Vidyasagar University, West Bengal. Thanks to both of you, sir, for very graciously agreeing to be our speakers of the day. Professor Pandey, in his illustrative lecture, not only focused on the challenges and opportunities in urban governance, but also analyzed economic patterns, driving forces, urban opportunities, focus areas for urban governance, restoration of cities, and importance of digital governance. Thank you very much, sir, from all of us for your very insightful and very intellect lecture. Professor Sebak Jana, on the other hand, focused on policy instruments for rural development and governance, structural support, major agricultural issues, impact of COVID-19 on rural economy, highlights of researches which he did and presented here as case studies, which give all of us clarity and insights into the subject. His presentation was illustrative, highlighting the very core of governance at the grassroots level. Thank you so much, sir, for being there for all of us. Thanks are due to my dear friend Pallavi, who not only readily agreed for collaboration, but also helped me in giving shape to a dream of organizing such kind of national e-symposium. She is efficient, humble, and hardworking, who left no stone unturned for making this symposium a success. Thank you so much, Pallavi. At home, I want to extend my heartfelt thanks to my head, Dr. Thuranjan Raj, and Dr. Shama Sharma, the senior most teacher of the department and also the function committee convener, for their constant guidance and support. Thanks are due to Dr. Vijay K. Bhatia, Dr. Shakti, Dr. Alankar, Dr. Ram Bagri, and Dr. Sunil for making every effort collaborative and also for supporting in every event. Thanks are also due to our technical expert, Mr. Ujwal. I can see him here as a host and his team for their support and managing the entire event by doing recordings, live streaming, and also by helping us in e-certificates after the symposium is over. Without you all, this event would not have been possible. Most importantly, I want to say thanks to all the participants on behalf of the organizers for remaining there with us throughout and listening to the experts very patiently and carefully and asking the questions. The feedback form link is provided in the chat box. It will be provided soon. I request you all to please fill the feedback form as it is compulsory for the e-certificates. Thank you all once again. Stay blessed, happy and safe. Work on enriching your academic endeavors and keep shining like bright stars. Thank you. I hope we all can meet again and stay safe. Thank you all. Namaskar.
Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. And just a small clarification. Professor Ujwal Chaudhary has graciously given his Zoom link. He's the Pro Vice Chancellor of Adamus University. And the technical support is given by Ranabrata Chand. So just since he may be getting access from Facebook Live, so I thought this clarity will be important. And thank you, Nidhi ma'am, for all the participation. And we look forward for the future event. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Have a very good day.